Well, good afternoon, everybody. In 2012, there was a big bang in AI when Jeff Hinton and some colleagues renewed, reintroduced, and refurbished an old AI process called neural nets and called it deep learning. And in the 10 years since then, a group of little companies in America and some companies in China as well grew enormous businesses by offering us products and services which are quite often simply miraculous. So Francis and Juan have asked me to speculate about what AI will do for us in the next 10 years and to raise what may well be some of the challenges in that process. The Big Bang that happened in 2012 is fairly well known, but what's less well known is that there was probably a second Big Bang in 2017 when a paper was published by some Google researchers called Attention is All You Need, and that introduced the concept of transformer AIs, nothing to do with these guys, fortunately. Transformer AIs predict the next token in a sequence. That's pretty much all they do. And the token can be a word or a part of a word, or it can be an image, or it can be a sequence of code. So, three product areas, which are going to change dramatically in the next 10 years because of all this. Let's start with phones. At the moment, Siri and Siri's friends Alexa, Cortana, or whatever Google's calling their one today, they can answer a question, but they can't really sustain a conversation. And thanks to natural language processing, that's changing, and you will start having conversations with your phone. Hopefully it will be optimized so that it doesn't turn into a raging psychopath like Microsoft's Tay. This gentleman is Blake Lemoine. Blake Lemoine was a Google engineer who was fired because he persisted in saying that a Google system he'd worked on called Lambda had achieved consciousness. It clearly hadn't, and he was sacked for continuing to say it. But what he did is going to become more and more common. More people are going to look at their, or listen to their device and say, hang on, there's something going on here. This is a smart creature. And eventually, they will be. And eventually, probably, we will have AGI, and then things are really going to get interesting. I think probably within 10 years, we won't any longer be interacting primarily through the internet through our smartphones. We'll be doing it through smart glasses. I suspect that by 2032, we'll see as many smart glasses on city streets as we currently see smartphones. So the next product area is self-driving cars. And as we all know, we should be excited about this because humans kill 1.35 million other humans every year around the world by running them over. If you're between 5 and 24, I think it is, around the world, your most likely chance of dying is through a road accident. Humans are actually pretty good drivers. It's not true that we're not good drivers. We are pretty good, but we do get distracted and we do get tired and sometimes we get drunk or angry and then we cause accidents. And machines don't do that. They don't suffer from those limitations. So to paraphrase Agent Smith from The Matrix, we're sending humans to do a machine's job and we really should stop doing that. Now, self-driving cars have missed their deadlines numerous times. I'm one of the many people guilty of setting predictions when they would be ready for prime time, and they've blown through that. Ford and Volkswagen have dropped out of the process of developing them. And a lot of people think that actually, it turns out it's really, really hard to do, and we won't have self-driving cars for decades. I think they're wrong. I think they're wrong because Waymo and Cruise, so Waymo is a spin-out of Google, and Cruise is a division of GM, have got self-driving taxis with members of the public running around in them in Phoenix and San Francisco. And they are going to roll them out slowly to other cities. And it makes a lot of sense to do it slowly. It'd be crazy to do it quickly. Elon Musk's Tesla is doing it from a different angle and taking a slightly riskier approach. And then the third product area I want to talk about, another sort of physical manifestation of software is robots. Oh, sorry, yes, I wanted to just raise one of the things that self-driving cars does, one of the concerns that it may well raise. When self-driving cars are common in streets all around the world, I think that might be the moment when people start to take seriously the idea that AI is going to lead to joblessness. It's not going to happen anytime soon. I think it's probably 20, 30 years away. But if machines keep getting better and better, they will get to a point where they can do pretty much anything we can do for money. We'd better have sorted out in advance what the economy should look like in which robots do all the work and we have fun. I think it's possible, but we have very little idea how to do it at the moment. And self-driving cars could be the thing that raises that to the top of the agenda. The word robot comes from a 1920 play written by a Czech playwright called Karel Čapek. He got the word from a Slavic word which means forced labor, so make of that what you will. Unfortunately, in RUR, the robots rise and kill the human masters. 7 years ago, there was a DARPA Grand Challenge of robotics, and this was the typical result. They just kept falling over. And now, robots from Boston Dynamics and others can dance much better than I can. I will confess that these days that's not setting a very high bar. If you haven't seen it, I highly recommend the film, the short video, Do You Love Me? Boston Dynamics, Do You Love Me? It's a brilliant dance movie. I think it's quite possible by 2032 we'll have the first lights out factory or warehouse. Amazon is working hard to achieve this. A factory where there aren't any humans working, it's all robots, and so there's no need to have any lights on. Robots that we call drones are making headlines in Ukraine, and I think robots, like, I think drones may well be the first widespread form of lethal autonomous weapon systems, which everybody wants not to happen, and probably will happen, and we need to be thinking a lot more about this as well. So robots raise this serious concern about our AI future. And good old Elon Musk, love him or loathe him, he's making it harder and harder to love him. He thinks that humanoid robots will be a much bigger product line for Tesla than cars within some time period, and he calls them Optimus. And he's got a track record of making quite extraordinary things happen, even though he's usually a little bit over-optimistic about the timelines. So that was three product areas and some of the concerns that they raise about AI. Let's have a look at a couple of industries, a couple of worlds. First is healthcare. So monitoring devices like Apple Watch, Oura Rings, Fitbits have been around for quite a while. They get better and better every year. And they will do increasingly so a couple of very interesting things. Eric Topol, a doctor, a very prestigious doctor who's made quite a good career out of being rude to other doctors, says that we will get to a point where doctors are no longer sort of sages that we all have to bow down to and listen to and do exactly what they say. We will give them data, we'll give them information about ourselves rather than going to them for the information, and they will become coaches, and we will become the CEOs of our own health. And we could finally turn healthcare into healthcare and stop it being sick care, which would be a great thing. And in case you're wondering, the best place to put a monitoring device? In the ear or in the rear? Meet Alexander Zhavoronkov, who's from Latvia, not from Russia. He is the founder and CEO of InSilico Medicine, which is one of the number of companies developing drugs using AI. And his three-stage process has proved beyond question that if you use AI to develop drugs, you can do it much, much more cheaply, much more quickly, and with much less risk. So he's developed a drug, and I'll get this wrong, it's for idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, yay, which is now in clinical trials. And he did it in 18 months and for a few million quid, whereas normally it takes over a decade and billions, and 90% of drugs that make it to clinical tests don't work. The super tankers that we talk call drug companies are trying to adopt this, but it's going to be quite a slow process. But when they do, the benefits will be enormous. At the same time, AI is making basic science discoveries. AlphaFold, a system developed by DeepMind, owned by Google, has worked out the folding behavior of 200 million proteins, which is pretty much all the basic building blocks of life on Earth. Ray Kurzweil, probably one of the world's most famous futurists, has been saying for a very long time that by 2029, we'll have something called longevity escape velocity, which means every year that passes, you get a bit older, but medical science gives you a year back, which means you don't actually get any older, which means death is kind of permanently postponed. And as the science gets better, then we can rewind our age. Now, Kurzweil is quite controversial. A lot of people think he's crazy. I think personally his timelines are usually a bit late, but he often does get things right. Last week I spoke to the chap who invented the term longevity escape velocity, a man called Aubrey de Grey, who I understand has been here. And Aubrey is now increasingly optimistic about LEV. He thinks it may happen in 2015, but what he thinks will happen 3 years from now is that we'll have laboratory proof that it's possible in the form of therapies for mice. Now, mice don't live long enough to have LEV applied to them, but you can take a middle-aged mouse, say, two-year-old mouse, and give it an extra year of life. And if we can do that using the therapies that can be applied to humans, humans are going to start waking up. It's going to be on the Oprah Winfrey Show. When the world realizes that actually we might all live to 1,000 years old, or maybe our kids will live to 1,000 years old, that is going to be an earthquake. And an awful lot of people are not going to be happy about it. A lot of people will say, hey, you're playing God, or this is just a rich man's fetish, or you're going to overpopulate the earth. And I think there's going to be the mother of all culture wars about this, and we're not talking about it yet. I'm quickly going to dash through the metaverse, the second industry, which is an age-old concept, the idea that humans will live in simulated worlds. And it's in the news at the moment because last October, Mark Zuckerberg publicly pinned the future of Facebook on it and renamed his company as Meta. And the reason why he's done that is he thinks that smart glasses are just about ready. The technology is just about ready for portable devices which can track motion in the real world. And so smart glasses can replace smartphones. He really, really wants to be a player in that ecosystem. The part of Facebook, part of Meta, which is developing, it's called Reality Labs. They spend about 20% of Facebook's total expenditure. People work in it say that his resolve, his focus on the project is so fierce, it's like working under the eye of Lord Sauron from Lord of the Rings. And we don't yet know when it will be that many people will have smart glasses, but as I say, I think probably by 2032 they'll be pretty common. Every new medium has a moral panic. Somebody asked earlier, why are we worrying about the ethics of the technologies we're developing at the moment where we didn't in the past? I don't think that's true. I think that we have always worried about new technologies and new media. Socrates, 2,500 years ago, said that writing should be banned because it meant people would lose their memories. The printing press, when it came out a couple of thousand years later, was very strongly opposed by the Catholic Church and others. Radio, TV, telephones, the internet, video games, there's a moral panic about all of them. And there will be moral panic about the metaverse as well. People will worry that Facebook's going to control it, which it isn't. There's going to be a lot of different platforms, and they'll either be walled gardens or more likely an open system. People will worry that a lot of people will disappear into the metaverse and never be seen again, and these people are called teenagers. But actually, they'll be hanging out with their friends. You know, we've been programmed by hundreds of thousands of years of evolution to be intensely social, and a couple of decades of a technology isn't going to change that. And they're worried about the digital divide, that there'll just be some rich people who've got access to virtual reality and the metaverse, and everybody else won't be part of the digerati and be left behind. This doesn't always go down very well, but I always reply to that by saying, well, where's the fridge divide? Where's the smartphone divide? If a technology works, if it's effective, then companies will make a lot more money supplying affordable versions to everybody than by supplying a few diamond-encrusted versions to oligarchs and celebrities. There are some things to worry about the metaverse. Privacy is a concern which AI and the internet have already raised, and the metaverse is going to aggravate it. And so there are things to worry about, but there's also a lot more concerns than there need to be. So I'm just going to finish by making a couple of comments about Europe, about where we'll be in 2032 and about Europe. The AI that we have in Europe in 2032 will probably mostly not be developed here. It'll be developed by these companies and by their opposite numbers in China, the BAT companies and the Chinese government, which invests very heavily in AI as well. And this is a list of, or a chart of all the great European tech giants. There aren't any. And I think this is a shame. I think it's a problem. Because I don't think it's healthy, and I don't think it's wise for humanity's most powerful technology to be a duopoly between America and China. No disrespect to our American and Chinese friends, but Europe, I think, should be playing. And Europe has a lot to offer. It's a very rich part of the world. It has large, well-run companies. And it has fantastic universities churning out great AI researchers who will go off and work for Google and for the Chinese companies. I think really Europe needs to step up its game and take part in this activity. It's had a few possible goes. One was the Human Brain Project, which was really inspirational when it was launched in 2013. The idea was to build a human brain. But it turned out that was a little bit too visionary for a lot of people, and there were academics who feared they weren't getting their share of the budget. And so the visionary founder, Henry Markham, was removed, and he's been pretty much whitewashed out of the story. And the Human Brain Project now, it's still going, but I follow it on Twitter, and I can't understand what they're doing. It's certainly not a visionary moonshot project, which is a shame. That is the kind of thing I think Europe needs to do to get back into, or to get into, the AI business. AI is not a race. There is no end point, and it's not winner takes all. AI benefits all of us, whether it's developed in Menlo Park or Malaga. But Europe can and should contribute to it. And it needs to do some quite bold, visionary, and very expensive things if it wants to participate. I hope it does. Thank you.